Today's video broadcast is going to be on Acts 12:1 through 12, and we're going to look at an impossible situation Peter found himself in. And I'll read the passage 1 through 12 of Acts 12. It was about this time Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw this meant the approval among the Jews, he proclaimed, proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the festival of unleavened bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of soldiers, and four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for a public trial after Passover, so Peter was kept in prison, but the church earnestly prayed for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell, struck Peter on the side, and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said. The chains fell off Peter's wrist. The angel said to him, "Put your clothes and sandals. Put on your clothes and sandals." And Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." And the angel told him, Peter followed him out of the prison. But he had no idea what the angel was doing or what was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. Then he passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they walked through it. When they had walked the length of the street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the Herod's clutches and everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen." When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, and also called Mark, where many people gathered and were praying. So what can we learn from this story? Now let's take a few observations. First off, Herod arrested some belonging to the church, intending to persecute them, the text says. And then he had James killed with a sword. When he saw that meant approval among the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. So we might wonder why he wasted the time to just first kill James, John's brother, not James the half-brother of Jesus, but the John's brother, not to be mistaken with the James that wrote the book of James, where that is the half-brother of Jesus that wrote that book, but this James is actually the brother of John. But if we look at Herod's possible motive behind such an action, we could get a real clue that the guy loved most the approval of people, and even if it meant getting it from doing evil. So we see Herod intended to bring him out for a public trial after Passover. We must ask the question, after reading this text, and say, why does the text make it known that Herod wanted to give Peter a public trial? Well, for one, I think what we see is earlier on in the text, it seems that Herod wanted to get points with the Jews that were wanting to persecute the believers. So when he saw having James executed with the sword got him the attention he wanted, he became like one who tried to keep the hits rolling, so to speak, as the expression goes. However, let's take a look. He has Peter put in prison until he can decide what to do with him and bring him out for a public trial after Passover. And the passed by those first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened by itself, and they went through it. They had walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left them. So, we see, the light of the Lord came into the dark place, and the angel of the Lord appeared before him. Woke him up, prompted him to get up in haste. His chains miraculously dropped off. The angel says to follow. Peter at first thinks he's having a vision. He passes the guards. The gates open on their own. And even shortly after, the angel stays by him until he's out of the woods, truly out of danger. So, I think a good application for this, this passage we've read, is this can be vary for each of us. We're not, like, literally in prison. Most of us aren't in a prison, chained to two soldiers, or chained to people we don't want to be around, but we all, as believers, may not be imprisoned literally between two soldiers. Yet there comes points in our lives where we are in a conundrum and things seem bleak and hopeless. Some of us may have been in this kind of dark spot of life, or have come out of one we knew we felt like this, or even we may in the future feel we have no hope of escape unless God does something miraculous. And he can still blow our minds with guiding us through dark places in life. Peter obeyed the Lord by doing what the angel said to do, and he just basically followed the instructions he was given. He follows the messenger, and then he gets to the gate that would have kept him confined, and it mysteriously, by God's power, the gate just swings open on its own, and Peter is released. So, if God could do this in Peter's life, because Peter trusted him and followed, of course, since the angel was sent by God, Peter was truly ultimately following the Lord. We can't mistake that. God used a lesser angel to be his means to deliver him from that dreadful situation. The text does not directly state the angel of the Lord. Oftentimes, when it says the angel of the Lord, it's talking about the prefiguration of the very Lord Jesus Christ, the angel of the Lord throughout the Old Testament. And later on I can do a broadcast explaining that, but we can assume this is probably just an ordinary angel that had come, regardless of being sent under God's will. Obeying God and trusting him in difficulties is the way we truly excel through our challenges. We must follow him and not ask questions that keep us from just following. Peter did not have the time to really mull over what was going on as he followed the Lord. Later he realized what had truly taken place. So that is often true of us. You know, we may not know what's going on until after God brings us out of a situation and we look back in hindsight. Or we may not fully understand until we get to heaven. And, you know, we just got to trust him and obey him. You know, Peter just basically followed, obeyed, did what he was instructed. God shows us an extraordinary power to bring him out of that situation. And, you know, I think it's interesting the chains just fell off. You know, God wants to set us free from, most of all, spiritual and emotional bondage that we're in. You know, just if we think about it, what can we think of in our lives? As individuals, we can think of a lot of different things, varying from person to person. What kind of things are holding us back? You know, what kind of things have gotten us chained? See, for some, it might be resentment, it might be bitterness, it might be struggles with past baggage that are chaining them to the past. It may be a situation they don't want to be in. It may be something that just seems enormous. You know, whatever that may be, if it's going to interfere with God's perfect plan for our lives, God is going to make a way for us out of that. God's ultimate will is for us to become more like Jesus Christ and to become the more the reflection of what Christ calls us to be, to reflect his nature and character. So anything that really interferes with that goal, we got to trust that God will make a way to deliver us from whatever it is that's holding us back. And I think we got to really pray. You know, we see that prayers were being offered. We got to it and pray for us. You know, that's what we really need. Then we got to ask people to pray for us. Sometimes that takes a lot of humility. Sometimes we have to just open up and say, you know, I'm not wanting to open up about this, but I'm going to. You know, James 5:16 says the prayer of the righteous person is powerful and effective. And so when we ask people to pray for us that are really walking in the Spirit, that is a real helpful tool we have as Christians. We can rely on other believers' prayers. And then we can also do that same thing for other believers that are struggling. We can pray for them and lift them up. And, you know, God was using prayer as a way to accomplish His purpose. God could have done it without anybody's prayer, but you know what? God oftentimes chooses to do is He chooses to use prayer as one of the methods. He lets us partner with getting His will done on earth. It's not that God needs our prayers. It's not that that prayer and faith is just some magic wand to get what we want out of God. That's not it at all. But it's a way we can partner with what God truly wants to do. Prayer is us choosing to partner with God and ask Him to do what He wants to do on earth as it is in heaven. As Jesus taught, Father, who art in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And you know, our prayer should follow that same kind of model. We should pray, Lord, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your will be done in my life as it is in heaven. Let your will be done in the lives of your people, those you saved by your grace, as it is done in heaven. Lord, work in your people, my life, and this world in a way that glorifies and pleases and honors you, so people will know that you are truly all-powerful and you are God. You know, prayers like that are very powerful. When we align our request in alignment with what we know God already wants to do. So, that's the first step. And then we got to be persistent in prayer. We got to keep praying. It says they were praying. Basically, I think it says they were praying nonstop for him, you know. And it's, let's just take a look here. Take a look. I think it was talking about how the church was earnestly praying. The people of God were earnestly praying for him. And they kept praying. And, you know, they were praying when he showed up. When he showed up to greet them, they were praying still. So, you know, prayerfulness is a very important part of the Christian life, is to be continually in conversation with God. It doesn't mean you pray every single second of the day.